Thank you for those inspiring words, and we're really happy that you were able to join us. I now have the pleasure of introducing today's keynote speaker, a soon-to-be Fulbright scholar, Dr. Alexandra Glavanakova. She's the head of the English department at Sophie University, and she will hopefully be taking up her Fulbright grant at the University of California, Santa Barbara, at some point in the next year. We invited her to open our conference because she began her fascinating research on reading in the digital age even before the rise of the pandemic. So we're hoping her insights will set a framework for our discussions today and tomorrow. Dr. Glavanakova, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Angela. Hi, everybody. I'm really, really happy to be with all of you today. I would like, first of all, to thank our hosts, the Bulgarian Fulbright Commission, for organizing this very timely and important event. And I'm really looking forward to today's and tomorrow's discussions and talks. The sight of the silent reader who is deeply contemplating the book is a very humanistic image that we have, but it's something that we don't see very often today. Actually, as readers and educators, we are aware that the attitude towards reading has shifted and changed. So you see here this portrait of a scholar by Rembrandt from the 17th century, which is one attitude, and the way that he was note-taking. Another attitude comes from the Victorian age and the 19th century with this reader of novels, where you can actually spot the devil who is pushing, seducing with literature and novels the reader. And today's educators can only hope for the abandon with which this reader is looking at her novel. So, print reading is greatly reduced today, and it has dominated actually for a short period of time compared to other technologies, the reading experience. It has become, reading itself has become a complicated activity that takes place over multiple platforms. So the question which I posit today regarding the reading, especially literary reading, in the age of distraction, arises from my experience as a lecturer in American literature and culture at Sophie University for over 30 years now, and also my interest in electronic literature and digital culture, which has also been very interesting to me. So these two areas of research merged eventually in what I teach and also in my critical inquiry. So what I find almost every day, unfortunately, in the American literature seminar is a reaction of the sort, too long, didn't read, from my students. And so I'm wondering whether I should now recourse to a minimalist type of literature of the sort, this 6-word short story, For Sale, Baby Shoes, Never Worn, which has been attributed perhaps wrongly to actually Hemingway. And, you know, this type of minimalist fiction is akin to what we have today online called flash fiction or insta-read or even bookshots, what you can find very, very short summaries of whole books online. You can pay for that and then, you know, drink it. So I use the umbrella term of fast fiction for all of these. And just like fast food, it does cause indigestion, I would say. So all of this got me involved in a very important research, which was carried out by the Bulgarian Reading Practices Project, which is a national interdisciplinary project, and it's been financed by the Bulgarian Science Fund. It is a longitudinal study, which has taken place from 2006 onward. And it was only this year, actually, that a special work group, which was called Online Reading Modes Work Group, was founded, in which I participated and headed. So part of this Reading Practices in Bulgaria project was a massive research, sociological research, which was carried out by the Alpha Research Agency. And this survey encompassed 1,000 respondents over the age of 18. So what they found as a result of the survey actually overlaps with a lot of the findings in other surveys in other European countries and the United States. First of all, that the well-educated read more, that people with higher incomes read more, women read more than men, Women prefer fiction, men prefer non-fiction. An interesting point that came out of the survey, actually, is that Bulgarians, it seems, to prefer to watch television. About 88% do so every day. That's something that politicians and educators need to have in mind. And 56% browse the internet every day, as opposed to the 13 who read books every day. So probably one of the shortcomings of the survey was that it did not gather information regarding the reading behavior and preferences of Bulgarians under the age of 18. And I would very much be interested in that in the future. Most, as you can see, 27% of the respondents are retired, with nearly 30% over the age of 60. So there is a huge shift in the reading experience, but the whole digital ecology has actually shifted, and that's what I would like to talk a little bit about. So first of all, this new digital ecology has been marked by the rise of deep learning, artificial intelligence, and I will give some examples a bit later. There is also a very important increase in the scale and velocity of text technology, so that, you know, the printing press and the printed book is just one technology which, as I said, is only historically limited. On the other hand, we have the democratization of the literary text. By this, I mean that now we have a lot of online archives and a lot of books are freely available across the digital divide to many readers if they wish to read them. On the other hand, we also have the rise of the augmented texts, augmented in the sense just like the human body can be augmented, you know, become a cyborg. In a similar way, by using the technology, we can have even literary texts that have become more available to us with a lot of links regarding the background, the history, the literary criticism dedicated to a certain text, and of course, distant reading technology, which is part of it. So let me illustrate the point about deep learning, artificial intelligence, and this will explain where part of my title comes from. Possible Minds is actually the title of an important book that was published in 2019. And here a lot of researchers, 25 to be exact, were thinking and debating not just about the nature of intelligence, but also about the fact when general intelligence will arise, that is equal to human intelligence, and that some posited will happen in 20 years, others said in like 200 years. We know that nowadays we basically have partial intelligences, which are only very good and surpass human intelligence in certain domains, like if you're thinking about chess, the games of chess and the games of Go, or if you're thinking about, let's say, automated personality profiling, or even the potential development of lethal autonomous weapons, as they're called now, slaughter bots. So the space of possible minds is actually quite large. As you can imagine, part of it is occupied by the natural minds, which is the human mind and the animal minds, and the other part by the artificial intelligence. So when discussing this question, I would like to say that in the age of humanism, we got our lessons about, let's say, morality, about ethics, from storytelling and from different narratives that we read. However, what is happening now in the age of post-humanism, following, you know, humanism? And I would like to give here as an example a very interesting project which has been developed by the University of California at Santa Barbara Media Neuroscience Lab, and it's called the Moral Narrative Analyzer, or MONA. And this particular project uses artificial intelligence, so it uses different computer algorithms, large-scale text mining, combined with evaluations by a large number of humans. So actually humans and machines are combined together in trying to find what are the main patterns that you can find in certain narratives regarding morality and ethics. So they find these patterns by reading a massive amount of data that is associated with news, even with movie scripts or with song lyrics. And I think that this is very interesting because what Mona exemplifies is the potential of the computationally enhanced reading of texts, whether we call it distant reading or machine reading or something else, and even regarding something as complex as a moral framework. So my question is, how far can artificial intelligences go in this competition with humans in reading, and especially bearing in mind their inscrutable neural networks? And one answer to my question has been offered by a novelist, and this is Ian McEwan with his book Machines Like Me, which was published also in 2019. So the main character of this this novel, this speculative fiction, is a humanoid who is called Adam. And Adam has a very dubious role in this particular novel. He actually, at one point, refuses to tell what we would call a white lie to save another person from going to jail for a crime of righteous retribution. So it seems that the robot, in this case, Adam, takes a higher moral ground, is more rigid in the application of moral rules and behavior in comparison to the human. So his human owner actually murders him, is brought to the point of murdering him. So it's interesting because in this case, the machine arrives at a certain decision based on, so to say, a programmed ethical calculus. And that is also based on the whole of history of human behavior, which is available, of course, to artificial intelligence. So as the robot starts to gain more human lessons and understand more about humans, the more he gets into a state of despair. And eventually, the suffering becomes so unbearable for the machines in this novel that they end up self-destructing themselves. The this kind of existential angst which they experience comes from their inability to understand human decision-making. So for this reason, actually, Adam envisions in the place of traditional forms of learning a cloud where we can share our thoughts and ideas and concepts, kind of merge, as he says, into an ocean of thought. And the next point which he makes is that having read most of human literature, he argues that everything in fiction describes varieties of human failure. So for him, in this projected future, literature will be obliterated. It becomes redundant because, as he says, we'll understand each other too well. Our literatures will lose their unwholesome nourishment. We'll look back and marvel at how well the people of long ago depicted their own shortcomings, how they wove brilliant, even optimistic fables out of their conflicts and monstrous inadequacies and mutual incomprehension. End of quote. So I think that for an orthodox humanist, Adam's utopia actually masks a nightmare. But what about a technophile transhumanist? Maybe for that person, indeed, literature is something that will soon disappear. So it's against this particular background that I'm actually looking into reading today. And just a very brief reminder here that reading originated some 6,000 years ago, that because that's a very short period in human history, there are actually no specific genes in us, and that there have been other centers in the brain which have mutated to allow us to learn to read. And this, of course, is because of our brain plasticity, which is what we need to have in mind also when we're thinking about the new reading modes. So basically, there are two types of reading. One is the so-called tabular The other is linear. Tabular reading is what we very often do online. We actually switch, of course, between the two. But the tabular type of reading is the one that is focused on information seeking and pattern recognition, also quick decision making. So it's very useful. It's not something that we need to, you know, destroy. But what about linear reading, which is sustained, focused, solitary, and it is the one that actually facilitates knowledge formation, and that is why we need to pay attention to it too. Now, neuroscience, which has looked very deeply and closely at the reading process in the last 30 years, has actually established that decoding a message, that is reading it, takes an estimated 200 to 500 milliseconds. And it is only after that period of simple decoding that we can think our own thoughts and have our own feelings. So then the question is, do we allow ourselves this time, especially in the process of tabular reading? So what we find today is the rise of the new normal, which is scanning, browsing, skimming. And the features of this type of reading are, of course, continuous partial attention, we're aware of this, decreased working memory, multitasking, the need for high levels of stimulation all the time, low-level threshold for boredom, the addiction to novelty. And technology has allowed us to actually track the way that eyes look at the screen, where they focus. And it has this eye tracking experiments has revealed that actually our eyes move mostly in the mode of the letter F on the screen, so we see just this part, or in a zigzag mode. The rest we just miss. It's not something that we read. Deep reading, of course, is at the opposite end of the spectrum, and this is what we are naturally aiming at, especially when we're thinking as educators, because it is precisely deep reading that helps us develop critical thinking skills, reflection, insight, empathy, epiphany. And as Marianne Wolf has written, she is a very famous neuroscientist studying cognitive process in the Reading Act. So this is what she says, that the digital culture's pervasive emphasis on immediacy, information loading, and a media-driven cognitive set that embraces speed can discourage deliberation in both our reading and our thinking. So the focus then would be of research, and of course our goal as educators, to create the biliterate brain. It's of course modeled on the idea of the bilingual brain, just like you can be proficient in two languages. In a similar way, would it be possible to train the brain in such a way so that it would know when to read deeply and when to skim, scan or browse? This is the main question. And before I get to the point where I tell you what my research is actually focused on, I would like to very briefly mention about the other research in the field. So it's explosive, actually, the reading research that's been going on. And I guess that even by the end of this presentation, some of the things which I have said will already be outdated because the field is developing so quickly. Actually, up to the 1990s, it was believed that research revealed that reading on screen is slower and with less comprehension. But since the 1990s, there have been mixed results regarding reading comprehension on page versus screen. And here I am talking about the type of texts which are similar in the sense if you're reading a short story on paper and you're also reading it on screen in a linear fashion. It could be an e-reader, a device like a Kindle, or it can be a laptop, but the important thing is that you can draw a comparison there regarding, you know, the format. And several very important research groups have been founded in the last decade, and they have come up with interesting results. One of them has studied specifically how academics, that is how students read, and they have studied over 100,000 university students from 21 countries regarding academic reading. And they have come to the conclusion that print reading is still the preferred mode, even for digital natives, whenever they have a longer text to read. And by long, They mean over 7 pages. The next important outcomes are summarized in the Stavanger Declaration, which is a declaration published by the EU-funded group of 200, I think, researchers that studied the evolution of reading in the age of digitization. And it's interesting that they came to the conclusion that when reading long-form informational text, comprehension is stronger on paper versus screen. But the same is not true for narrative. So it seems that when you're reading a narrative in a linear fashion, that is okay, whether it's on paper or in screen, that's not a problem. The other, however, important finding is that contrary to expectations about the behavior of the digital natives, it seems that screen inferiority increases rather than decreases over time. In other words, we would expect the digital natives, the millennials who have grown up in a digital environment, to be very good actually in reading online, but that is not the case. It seems that just the opposite line of decline has been observed for 17 years. And of course, the very important point which is made in the Stavanger Declaration that the digital text can offer excellent opportunities to tailor text presentation to an individual preferences and needs. And I think we can use that. Now, why is it so counterintuitive, this finding that screen reading is inferior to paper reading in terms of comprehension, even when we're talking about digital natives? So researchers offer what we call the metacognitive deficit hypothesis. So metacognition, this is cognition about cognition. In other words, you're thinking about how you're thinking. During the reading act, you're constantly asking yourself, do I understand this? Have I read this before? Are these facts true? How will I comment on this? What questions come to my mind? And this metacognition is actually not happening for the digital natives. And that is the reason on screen. That is the reason why paper is still the preferred mode. Also, another idea that's been offered is that a lot of the digital natives, when they read on screen, they have an inflated sense of understanding and they overestimate their own performance. And the third point, of course, is that reading on screen actually affects a lot human memory. And a lot of my students would say, why do I need to know the titles of, you know, the Shakespearean great tragedies? I can always Google those. So these kind of cognitive habits that have now developed, have a bleeding over effect also in print reading, which leads to very serious problems that we have in Bulgaria with functional literacy. And this is what has been established by the PISA survey, which also, you know, happens every 3 years. It's conducted in many countries. So, of course, that has gotten a lot of educators worried about the future of reading. Apart from this comparison between print and screen reading, there are many other tendencies. I really don't have the time to go into all of these, but one of the most important and interesting, I think, for them is the so-called embodied cognition and the fact that we are always using our hands when we are on screen. You know, we need to click and so on and so forth. It's not that we don't use the digitally the finger when you're reading. We also do that sometimes, but here this navigational act and this coordination between eyes and hands is also becoming very important. So a lot of researchers are actually looking into that. So what is actually finally getting to the focus of my research and why I think that this is important? Because today, with this crisis that we're in, we're actually forcing our students to do a lot of work online, which means that they're doing a lot of reading online all the time. And this is actually strengthening further, probably developing and strengthening further the screen reading modes that I was talking about previously. And they would eventually, as I said, have this effect also on paper reading as well, print reading. So all these people who are participating online in the communication actually are leaving digital footprints. And this is their digital presence, of course. And these digital footprints, this digital presence comprises a lot of data that can be further analyzed through the methodology of distant reading, just like in the Mona example, especially by text mining or, let's say, sentiment analysis. And for me, a place where I can look for this data is actually social reading, which happens, of course, on the social platforms. And social reading goes back in the past. It's something which we call collective reading. It's happened before historically. Just think about people when they didn't have money to buy a Bible and they would sit around together. One would read, the rest would be listening. And also in this process of collective reading, you have collaborative meaning making, which is what is really important for me, I think. So social reading nowadays takes place on different platforms for book reviews like Goodreads, in online book clubs, in collaborative crowdsourced writing platforms, and also on special platforms designed for writing. And again, there is a precedent for this. If you just remember Robert Stein, who spearheaded the Institute for the Future of the Book, and with him we also have several important projects in this kind of social reading. One of them comes from 2008, the Golden Notebook Project, where actually there were seven women who were reading online and commenting on Doris Lessing's famous novel, The Golden Notebook. And here you can see one such page with their comments and also the comments that were allowed by other, so to say, non-involved in the project readers that could also participate and kind of peep into what is happening in the reading process. So what the author here said is that what we have is like turning the novel, turning a document into a conversation and allowing, you know, the different readers to discuss it openly. Of course, again, this practice, like the book clubs, is not something that is new for reading. It's just that the technology now has developed and allowed us to be more open about it, because marginalia annotation in printed books or even in some manuscripts is something which we have had historically again. And it is a kind of an asynchronous reading process that is happening there. And once again, a kind of a collaborative meaning making that we can associate to today's social platforms. So digital media then create new social valences of reading, which involve this possibility of constant communication. And I would like here to give the example of Wattpad, which is really a mega platform for creative writing. So it is here that people can come and write their stories. And while they're writing them, you also have readers who are commenting on them all the time. So that, I think, is also a very good example. It offers, the platform offers 20 different genres. Of course, the teen fiction section is probably the most developed one, but you also have a classic section. You have millions of texts and readers that are being produced there for free. It's in 50 languages also, so you can actually, if you Google Bulgaria, you will get 262 stories back, some of which are completed, like 65, I believe, have been finished. The rest are works in progress, so you can read in different languages there. Why is it important to study social reading on such mega platforms? Because I think that what happens when you're reading in this way is that it activates your metacognition. You're always thinking about this passage, this paragraph, and what you're writing, your comments. And that is very important because it actually, we know that is part of the deep reading process that I talked about previously. So I will just give you another example from Wattpad with Pride and Prejudice to see the amount of comments that you can have. So it has 9 million reads, as you can see. The platform shows you reads, likes, and comments as well. So the novel on the whole has 9 million reads. Chapter 1 has almost 3 million reads. And just the first sentence has 4,500 comments by different readers. Just the first sentence of Pride and Prejudice. So this is really enormous amount of data that can be collected, as I said, and analyzed. And for me, the starting point is to look at the comments. And at this very initial stage, they can actually be categorized in two types. Comments which focus on affect, that is in trying to keep the conversation going. And the other type of comments which focus on content, and that those are the ones that I want to target, because they are comments about the book or the text that the reader is reading, about the quality of writing, about the characters, the language, the plot, the blurb, the title. Everything can be talked about, turning this document into a conversation. And in this way, actually, we can discover as researchers the patterns of online language use and whether any specific terms and concepts are being used there. So this kind of cartography of literary discourse that can come out, hopefully, this is what I'm hoping for, from the analysis of social writing and reading, which happen kind of simultaneously, almost synchronously on these platforms. The other thing, of course, that is interesting here is that we can focus on actual readers and their reading behavior, not what we call in literary criticism the implied reader. The implied reader, a concept introduced by Wolfgang Iser, and this is like a hypothetical reader who would be the optimal reader, who would get all the information, all the intentions of the author. So now we don't need to guess about this anymore because we have actual readers there in conversation with the writers of the text. So the long-term effect of this kind of research I'm hoping for is on the one hand to show this shift in literary criticism, which now belongs more with the layperson and not with the professional critic or the academic, which of course affects me as a university professor. And also, of course, to study what these platforms can teach us about reading, and then how we can teach reading to continue the trend towards deep reading and developing literacy. Thank you for your attention.
Great. Thank you so much, Professor Glavanakova. We have 10 minutes for questions. We'd like to encourage all of our listeners to write in the Q&A channel in the Zoom. So please feel free. I'll be reading your questions to Dr. Glavanakova. I guess in the meantime, I should ask my own question, because as a mother of a digital native, I feel sort of relieved that they are still doing metacognition when they're reading online. And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about, I was interested in your evolution of reading, because human language began as a verbal interaction, and then it became written, and now it's becoming digitized written text. Do you see us coming full circle? Where do you see audiobooks and audio online content, which is bringing the written word back to the spoken word? Does that have a place in your research at all?
Okay, that's a very interesting topic that you've touched upon, but I couldn't include everything in my presentation because, yes, indeed, part of this shift in the reading experience is the massive inclusion of different audiobooks on different platforms. And that would be, of course, a way of prioritizing, I guess, the auditory channel, which would allow for, again, different kinds of comprehension. But we don't know where that will really go. As I said, there are just areas in which we can hypothesize about the future developments of reading experience. So this is one way which we can probably look into, but I have not really studied that effect of listening to text so much. I have focused more on the visual aspects of reading.
I'm waiting for some questions on our chat channel, but in the absence of questions, I will ask my, this is nice, I get to ask all my questions that I want to find. As a university professor who's taught literature for 30 years, now that most of your students are reading these classics like Pride and Prejudice online, are the types of issues and the types of questions and topics that they're focusing on different from those when people are reading the physical book, or is it generally the same emphasis and reading experience for your students?
All right, this is again a tough question to answer because, as I said, if the situation is such that the students actually don't read the book, then there is no ground on which to have a real discussion, or they just skim and scan and browse through it. So they have a general idea what the book is about, and they very often would refer to sites that offer summaries of the book, and like, you know, what are the main themes, what are the main symbols, what are the main characters. So they would do meta reading, reading about the book instead of reading the actual book, or they would watch a movie about it. So different forms of remediation. And I think that that is also problematic, how to actually make them get engaged in the sense that they're interested in the reading process. And if that is probably done online, then it could be in a way better, I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Great. We have one question from our chat channel. Does Professor Glavanakova find her own reading habits have changed?
Oh, yes. Oh, indeed. Absolutely so. I think that most of us have this effect of, as I said, the bleeding over effect of reading too much online. So I have tried to discipline myself in a way to set every day a certain amount of time, like you would go to the fitness to work out. In a similar way, I would try to work out at deep reading, so that I would set time away from any kind of electronic devices and try to read carefully and deeply for that time. Otherwise, in terms even of academic reading, I would say that very often, and this is one of another research that I didn't mention, which studied the reading habits of academics, professors. Again, you have the same tendency of reading for gist, which probably existed even before that, but now it's becoming accelerated, so that less and less academics would read the entire text through. They would just scan, you know, this type of reading that is tabular, rather looking for the information. And we all know how careful we all are in our reading and in our writing as academics, how we very carefully have to choose every single word to express what we wish to express. So every word matters in that text, but very often it's not really read.
Great, thank you. The person who asked the question, Priscilla Howe, said, I like that idea of a deep reading workout. We can say when our children come to bother, stop, I'm working out, when you've got your novel. So thank you. We have one more question, time for one final question from Professor Tim Rice. Are there pedagogical techniques for helping students to engage with nonfiction educational texts beyond skimming?
All right, now, again, this is a difficult question because what I have looked into mostly is fiction, not nonfiction. Actually, if we're talking about reading today, we can say that reading on the whole has increased, generally speaking. So people do more reading, and they do more reading probably of nonfiction than of fiction. But the question is that it is this type of reading, which is deep reading of fictional text, which helps to create what I was talking about, critical thinking skills, and also especially empathy. It's something which, again, cognitive scientists have established through their research. And that even when you're reading about a character who is running, let's say, from somebody, there are parts in our brain which are activated for motion. So it's like we are identified with that particular character. So I'm really not aware how much the same kind of modes and behavior and patterns can be applied to nonfiction. So that is indeed somebody else has probably studied more than I have fiction.
Great. Well, I think we're out of time for questions and answers, but thank you so much, Dr. Glavanakova, for joining us today. It was a really fascinating study of how behavior has changed in the digital environment, our reading, our ways of grasping information, manipulating that information, reacting to that information. I think these are ideas that we're going to be continuing to discuss throughout the weekend. So thank you very much once again, and we look forward to new opportunities to engage with you. So thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Thank you.